Welcome to the Standard Deviations Podcast, presented by Orion Advisor Solutions and hosted by Dr. Daniel Crosby, Orion's Chief Behavioral Officer and New York Times best-selling author. Each week, Dr. Crosby interviews a fascinating new guest on a range of compelling topics, from literature to psychology to financial wellness. To learn more about Dr. Crosby's behavioral finance work at Orion, visit www.orion.com.
Hello and welcome to the Standard Deviations Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Daniel Crosby. I am joined today by the author of Fed Up, Colin Lancaster, who is a 25-year Wall Street professional. He's run two of the highest profile global macro businesses for top performing hedge funds in the world and has worked directly for a number of investment icons. Most recently, he was head of macro strategies at Citadel. He's a graduate of a little school you may have heard of called Princeton. He's a lawyer by original training, and in his spare time, between running macro funds and writing books, he enjoys yoga and reading. Colin, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's a real pleasure to be here. I've been looking forward to this.
No, absolutely. So we are here today to talk about your book. You are a fellow Harriman House author, so I was very happy to get you on the show. But before we get to Fed Up, I want to talk about the year that we've all been through. So as a behavioral guy, I want to talk, you have a unique take on the fear and greed that was so characteristic of 2020. What do you make of the fear, the greed, the short-termism that we saw in 2020? What sense do you make of all that?
Look, for me, it was a normal pattern in an extraordinary period of time, meaning markets are always a push and pull between a fear and greed type of cycle. Where you are in the business cycle, where you are in terms of building a bubble, in terms of speculative excesses, all of those components. And then all of a sudden, when the floor drops off, the bubble pops, all of a sudden fear takes over and everyone is just looking for safety. What was so extraordinary about last year is all of this happened in the course of about 3 weeks. Typically, a market crash happens over a period of 18 months or, certainly a much longer period. But you had, from, say, March 1st to March 23rd of last year, when the markets bottomed out down 35%, everything was accelerated. Everything was turbocharged in just this really extraordinary way.
So I have this pet theory that investors are currently primed to misbehave, primed for misbehavior in a way that's pretty unprecedented just because of what we went through last year. You know, it's been said that we went through 1929 and 1999 in the same year, and it really was kind of incredible. Do you agree with my pet theory here that investors are primed for misbehavior, or do you want to challenge it? Either option is open to you, sir.
Look, I think what's so interesting about markets, and I'm lucky, I'm the old guy now, so I've lived through a number of cycles. Really the first being the popping of the tech bubble, and then we had, the 98 Asian default crisis. You had 2008, all the way through to the current day. And I think what's really interesting, and this is a monetary policy phenomenon, it is largely a result of quantitative easing policy, which is obviously the Fed's favorite play to run these days. But people are so trained to buy the dip that there is a lack of fear of some of these events. In fact, everyone is looking for some type of pullback to be able to buy that, to put excess cash to work. And I do worry about that. I think that investors are trained to behave a certain way, and I think that that type of muscle memory goes a long time and it works until it doesn't. And when it doesn't work, watch out.
Yeah. So you've touched on one of the themes of the book. Let's get into it in earnest. So your book Fed Up has a provocative subtitle. It's Success, Excess, and Crisis Through the Eyes of a Hedge Fund Macro Trader. Tell us a bit about the book and the title there.
Well, it's definitely a play on words, right? You can say, I'm fed up in kind of an angry way, or boy, the Fed is driving markets up, you know, driving markets to new all-time highs. You know, writing the book is something I've always wanted to accomplish. It's been on, you know, my list of things to do. I've always been an incredibly avid reader, and writers like Michael Lewis, I really admire them, because they can take this complicated set of facts and you know, surround it with a group of really interesting characters and turn it into a wonderful story that people want to continue to you know, turn the page. And I wanted to do something similar. You know, that this was such a crazy period of time, and to be able to capture both the markets and the spread of the pandemic through the eyes of a macro trader, which is what I know best, what was this great challenge, because, you know, markets are always, that they're always moving. They always have their own heartbeat, but to capture a crash, a recovery, the fear, isolation, you know, all of these feelings that we lived through last year was really a great exercise.
Yeah, I'm sure a great sort of, if nothing else, a great journaling exercise to make sense of it. You know, I write to make sense of my own world. And I think we all could have used a little more of that over the last 15 months or so. What drove your decision to frame it as a novel? So you talk about fiscal policy, the global economy, income inequality, all these sort of esoteric, wonky topics, but you do it in the vehicle of a novel. What drove that choice?
It was very intentional. And again, I wanted to take a complicated set of topics and make them relatable so people could really understand them. You know, if I called the book The History of Quantitative Easing, you know, the only people that would touch that are the geeks like me. You know, no one's going to read that. And I wanted to tell it in terms of more of a story with a great cast of characters and to make it a lot more fun, a lot more interesting, but still to deliver, you know, a serious message.
Yeah, well, there's a ton of research that shows that story is the sort of the spoonful of sugar that helps the medicine of hard learning go down. So I think it certainly accomplishes that. So you talked, of course, about the play on words in the title. Let's get to that, because I have a couple of questions for you there. So in the book, you tackle quantitative easing, the role of central banks in the modern economy, and you believe that both have had a negative impact on the global economy. Say more about that. What's your beef with the current policy?
I think current policy all came out of really good intentions. Central banks not wanting people to suffer and wanting to mitigate downturns in economic conditions. I think it's very dangerous right now, because to me, the fact that we continue to use the same play out of the same playbook for every type of market downturn, we're at a point of diminishing returns. You know, quantitative easing in particular, which I really take aim at, it has proven to be incredibly successful at propping up asset values, meaning making stocks go higher and bonds go higher. But I really feel like we're at a point of diminishing returns in terms of the actual tangible benefit that you see in the real economy. And at the end of the day, the low rate environment that we've been living in just becomes a tax on traditional savers. The middle class ends up really squeezed, because in this type of environment, where stocks are driven higher, you know, the top 10%, the top 1%, really benefit in what becomes unfair ways. You know, all the wealth that becomes generated really accrues to their benefit. You know, if you're someone working two jobs and living off of your own labor and don't have the dollars to invest in the market, you become much more at risk of being left behind. And that's something that I think is incredibly dangerous.
So let's talk for a minute about this. I spend more time on Twitter than is probably healthy or advisable. And one of the things that I've seen on Twitter for candidly, you know, probably 13 years is people angry at the Fed. you know, traders, investors, angry at the Fed, angry about quantitative easing, upset, you know, critical, many of whom have very cogent critiques of Fed policy. And also, they're getting killed, right? Like they've left a lot of money on the table. So at what point do you set the critique aside and sort of join the madness, as it were? Or is there a way to be critical of Fed policy and still make money? I guess how do you balance or keep in tension your critique of the Fed with the reality that the narrative has left folks behind who have been angry at the Fed for quite a while now?
I think that is such a great question, because you are so right that in this business, there are always the people that are predicting the next doomsday. And look, it may never come, you know, it may never come to fruition. And the people that I most admire, the investors, are those who tend to be incredibly pragmatic. And I want to point someone out on this, but Stan Druckenmiller, one of the icons of the macro world, one of the greatest compounders of wealth of all time. And I think he's a perfect example, because A, he's one of my favorite people to listen to when he gives an interview, because he does it in such a straightforward, folksy manner. But he's someone who is willing to speak up and say, look, I think this is the wrong policy, but I know how the game needs to be played as a result of that. So I'm still going to be able to generate outstanding returns. So I think that's a really important lesson for everyone who's investing, which is, you know, you can't get too stubborn with respect to your own views. And if you think we're on the wrong path from a political perspective or, you know, a Fed policy perspective, you know, that's one thing, but you can't let that get in the way of good risk taking and delivering, you know, really smart risk adjusted returns.
It's interesting, right? So if it's like there's almost an appropriate outlet for each concern, right? Like if you're upset about the Fed, write a book, go on TV, write a commentary. But perhaps don't let it color the way or unduly color the way you manage money. You know, Ben Hunt, sort of a market thinker that I really respect, has talked a lot about playing the cards versus playing the players. And I think, you know, for a long time, people were trying to play the cards and think about this in this sort of rational, black and white, analytical way. And then at some point, you just had to play the zeitgeist, right? You just had to play the players and sort of get on board or get left far behind. You know, speaking of sort of the prevailing zeitgeist, part of your critique of the Fed has to do with fears about rising U.S. debt and the cost of servicing that debt. Now, I have a memory of being a younger man and going to New York and seeing the like national debt clock that was like ticking at some like extraordinary rate. This is a very visceral memory for me. And my dad, you know, I'm from Alabama, so like grew up in this very sort of like practical home. And my dad is a financial advisor. And I used to think about sort of the national debt the same way that I thought about personal debt. And like, how could the same way that a family can't let their expenses get so out of line or get so heavily in debt, how could you let the country get so far out of line? And yet that belief system and that zeitgeist is getting dusted, right? I mean, in the era of modern monetary theory, I think increasingly there's smart people making good arguments that it just doesn't matter. So what is your argument that it still matters?
Look, there's a scene in the book where this team of you know, hedge fund traders is in Las Vegas, traveling down the Las Vegas Strip, and is looking at that exact type of billboard. And at that time, which was just pre-COVID, you know, the U.S.'s government debt stood at $23 trillion. To fast forward to today, that number is $29 trillion. So just over the span of, you know, 12 or 14 months' time, we've added another, you know, nearly $6 trillion of debt to that number. I am probably old-fashioned in that way. I think these things still matter. when you look at the size of that debt, and that doesn't include the unfunded liabilities we have, which probably takes it something closer to like $160 trillion. In theory, those debts need to be repaid at some point in time. We have been living in a world where, the policy behind this is eventually you grow your way out of that. So the debt is not a problem. It can be repaid. But in light of the lower growth, call it a 2% type of growth environment that we've had up until, this recovery from the COVID lows, and the low inflation environment, that's troubling. Now, the MMTers would say, look, when you have your own currency, it doesn't matter because you can continue to issue the debt and the results, if anything, will be borne by that currency over time. And that, the currency will devalue, it'll depreciate in some manner. I think these are all dangerous experiments. I don't think we have a lot of great sets of examples to look at to say, yeah, that's right. You can just continue to print dollars, to engage in debt monetization, to pay for these things without really having to worry about it from a currency perspective. And, again, I am not one of these doomsday sayers, which says that the U.S.'s status as the world's reserve currency is going to be lost overnight. But we're certainly taking this experiment to a new level right now. If you think about the rise of the Keynesians from the 40s to the 70s, in the 70s, we have the bout of inflation. People move more towards the monetarist. And at least now it seems like we're gonna kind of tackle that on both sides, which is continue with the more aggressive style of monetary policy to continue to throw on more on the fiscal side. And to me, what that means is that the paths are just more uncertain than I've seen at any time in my 25-year career in terms of what will the end outcomes really be.
You touched on this a bit earlier. I want to give you an opportunity to flesh it out more here. Another critique of yours has to do with the way that Fed actions have exacerbated wealth inequality. And I think this is on the tip of everyone's tongue. This is something we're all concerned about. And the problem seems to, for all of our worry, the problem seems to be getting substantially worse. So what do you see has fueled wealth inequality, and why do you see it as so unsustainable?
Look, it's really a combination of things. In some regard, we have been going through, a new industrial revolution with all of the new disruptive technologies, which has been amazing, right? It's made all of us more productive, and we can do more things on our iPhones. 10 years ago, I would have needed 10 or 15 separate devices, fax machine, and this and that, and it's all right on my phone now. But it are those changes combined with this policy where we prop up asset values, which really has unduly, those benefits have gone to the very top of the spectrum. And, they're fewer and fewer are just taking more and more. And look, this is something that the Fed studies now. It's something they call the superstar economy, where, fewer and fewer take more of the benefits. And I do feel like this has had a number of unintended consequences with more divisive politics, a rise in populism, not just in the U.S., but really on a global basis. And if you look at just over history, how much of new wealth goes to the middle class compared to the upper class, and if you look at this, and we're now back at Gilded Age types of levels where the top of the top take more and more. And I think history has shown that isn't sustainable, that people push back against it because, again, they feel like they're being left behind. And look, I'm such a huge advocate of having a strong middle class. I feel like I personally benefited from that, from an environment where you felt like if you work hard, you're given more opportunities, you can succeed. And, having success shouldn't be, find your best 3x levered ETF and let her ride, which that's how people get rich now. And I think that's very frightening.
So what's the answer then? If we are to enjoy this stronger middle class, what's the answer? Because if anything, wealth inequality is being exacerbated in the last few years. So what would you do differently?
Look, I think that this will come back to the fiscal side of the equation, how government dollars are spent in areas, you know, not what we've been seeing. It's not infrastructure. It's these things. It's things that'll give a real return on those investable dollars. It's reform of the education system. It's making sure that people really do have the skills that they need for the job market as it's evolving. You know, we can't train people for jobs that don't exist, and to really focus on those types of items. And it's an incredibly difficult thing to do, because this is, it will need to be more of a political solution, which is I don't always have a lot of faith in governments to spend dollars in the right way. So I do think it's a difficult issue.
So last question on your critique of the Fed. So let's say you are the Fed chair. It's March of 2020. You've got a once in a century pandemic coming, and folks are looking at you and saying, "What do I do?" So what, you know, you seem to sort of admit that a lot of what the Fed has done is well intended. What would you have done similarly? What would you have done differently if you were in the driver's seat over the past, you know, call it 18 months?
I probably would have done this in smaller size. I probably would have focused on a slightly different set of asset classes. Again, there's a lot of critique on the Fed. You know, does the Fed need to be buying investment grade Apple bonds? You know, does Apple need a lower coupon to be able to survive? You know, the answer is no. And unfortunately, you know, from the Fed's perspective, they only have a couple of tools, right? They can lower interest rates. They can engage in programs like QE. They can adjust the money supply through items like QE. But you could say that in some ways the Fed doesn't really have the tools to help Main Street, to help average people. You know, the tools that they have are more designed to help markets and to be a liquidity provider in markets. And I think that's something that needs to be really made clear, because you know, politicians themselves now can just put more and more pressure on the Fed to do these things when you have an economic slowdown. But the end result is you benefit the people at the very high end of the income spectrum. You know, that we need to find a balance there. And what one of the things I am concerned about is it seems like, you know, the Fed and Treasury are acting very much in concert. You know, in a lot of ways, you know, the Fed buys more of the bonds that the Treasury needs to issue to continue its deficit spending plan. So there is an issue where these things are happening hand in hand now, where you know, more so than at any time in history to me.
Yeah. So perhaps we're pulling the wrong lever altogether. Perhaps there's better mechanisms for helping Main Street. And that whatever the Fed does is going to unduly benefit the top, you know, 10% of folks. So go ahead.
No, and I think that is part of the intellectual appeal to MMT, which is it's something different. Look, mm-hmm. You know, we've been using this set of policies now for 20 years, and we know what the result is. You know, QE doesn't cause inflation. It really doesn't help the real economy. It really focuses on this other side, which is propping up asset values. And you know, the MMTers, you know, by you know, sort of being an advocate of freer spending and even helicopter money, you know, getting dollars into the hands of real people, I understand the appeal to that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So there was a gentleman who was on the show early on in the podcast. I don't know if you know him. His name's Corey Hofstein, super bright guy, one of my favorite sort of investment thinkers. And I asked him, you know, I said, look, why isn't someone like you out curing cancer? Like, I'm not even sure I want someone as bright as you in financial markets. You have a part in the book where a character, a macro trader named Boss, says, "We're not paid to do anything productive for society. We're paid to turn a pile of money into a bigger pile of money." So is this how you really think about this? How do you think of the role of asset managers, traders, and the financial services industry broadly in terms of the greater good?
Look, in a lot of ways, the answer to that is yes, that is our role. That is our job. Now, we can say that, the types of firms that I've historically worked for, invest on behalf of pensions and real pensioners. So you can say that you're doing a good thing for people that need it. But at the end of the day, we're paid to compound wealth, and it's an interesting job. Now I do continue to believe that markets are kind of the ultimate puzzle, and they grade you on a daily basis because if you're right or wrong by looking at your daily P&L. So there is an amazing energy to the markets, but I think the boss was right. We're paid to turn a pile of money into a bigger pile.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's something I wrestle with myself. I'm a clinical psychologist by education. I've absolutely loved my career in finance, and I've probably been more intellectually stimulated and certainly have gotten paid better as a result of working in finance than if I had gone into medicine. But it's an interesting question, and one I grapple with personally. Are my talents better used here because there is real good that I do in this world? But is it greater or a lesser good than the good I would do as a therapist? I don't know. Tough to say. So, Colin, last question for you before we give you a chance to sort of plug the book in earnest. You've worked for some of the greats. And the book was influenced by great minds like Ray Dalio, Paul Tudor Jones, Druck, others. When you think about the greatest minds, your sort of investment Mount Rushmore, what are the qualities that these folks share in common? When you sort of look at the common thread that runs through great investment thinkers, what qualities fall out for you?
To me, that they all have really sort of this heightened level of self-awareness, really understanding themselves, and always able to make sure they're in a position to make great decisions. They're this clarity of decision-making that I think is so impressive, because they'll admit that they're wrong when they're wrong, or the price action is telling them that they're wrong. They have amazing perseverance, which is if they have a setback, they don't let that destroy them. They'll use that to be even better and learn from it. And they also have this really unique combination of skills, which is, really respecting the market and, just from a visceral perspective, never wanting to lose money. That's the most terrible thing for them to feel. But also a willingness to take risks and knowing when they're on something before the markets and willing to size up and generate those excess returns. So it's a set of factors that I think is so unusual. It's Michael Jordan, hitting the three-pointer or whatever. They just get in a zone, and it's really incredible to watch.
Sure. So thank you for your time and your insights today. If people want to learn more about you, your work, you have a new fund, you have a new book, you have lots to promote, where can people learn more about you?
Yeah, come to www.colinlancaster.me. Google me. Lots of things will come up. I love the markets. I'm passionate about markets. And I also can consider myself to be an ongoing student of the markets. You never get your degree in this business. You're always learning.
Yeah, I often refer to myself as a student of behavioral finance because, when you combine human behavior with markets, nothing much more elusive than those two things. So I love the perspective.
Absolutely.
Perspective. All right, sir. Best of luck with the book. And thank you again for all you've shared today.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thanks for tuning in to Standard Deviations. If you can't wait till next week for more behavioral finance insights, visit www.orion.com. All opinions expressed by Dr. Daniel Crosby and podcast guests are solely their own opinions and do not reflect the opinion of or endorsement by Orion and its affiliates, subsidiaries, and employees. This podcast is for informational purposes only and should not be relied upon as a basis for legal, tax, and investment decisions. The opinions are based upon information the participants consider reliable.